What is up, you guys? Hope you're having an awesome day. I'm your host, Ayman Hassan, and welcome back to another video. Now, science is meant to have all the answers. We know full well it doesn't, but it has a lot of the answers. Not all of them, some of them. I mean, then it can also have the answers and then be wrong, but then again, aren't we all wrong from time to time? Yes, we are. It's okay. And you know I love talking, so let's just talk about science today. These are the top 10 scary times science has been wrong. Before I get into it, I just wanted to give a quick shout out to World of Tanks for sponsoring this video. Now, you guys know I'm a huge gamer, and World of Tanks PC is a free online game where you can either play alone, join a team, or create your own clan. Now, there are over 30 maps to play in, all inspired by real locations, and there's different modes you can try, like Frontline, where it's 30v30, or Ranked Battles, where you can just move up if you are the best one there. The graphics are top notch, and you can use over 600 tanks from the biggest tank building countries in the world. If you guys are interested in playing, you can use the code TANKTASTIC as a new registered player to get 500 gold, a premium tank, and 7 premium days on the game. The link will be in the description below if you are interested. Starting us off for number 10 is the organic body. James Hutton, a geologist from the 18th century, created the Gaia hypothesis in the 70s. In it, he had everyone convinced that Earth was a super organism, an organic body that would continually replenish and reproduce itself to infinitely provide for humans. That's a nice dream, James. That's a real nice dream. He predicted veins of granite would pass and mix through other layers of rock, which is actually true, but that isn't because the Earth is growing for us. He was wrong in multiple ways, but 100 years later, the Gaia hypothesis was still argued for as being the truth. It was replaced by the contracting Earth theory, which was also wrong. Coming in at number 9 is the key to obesity. Back in the early 90s, researcher Michael Weintraub concluded that a mix of two non-addictive drugs that were discovered years ago could potentially be the key to the long-term control of obesity. Combining phentermine, a stimulant, and fenfluramine, an appetite suppressant, started the fen-phen diet craze. Doctors started prescribing them to patients wanting to lose 10 to 15 pounds, but years later, a report in the New England Journal of Medicine revealed otherwise. Using fen-phen for more than 3 months resulted in a high risk of developing primary pulmonary hypertension, which is a very fatal lung disorder. AKA not the cure to obesity. A year later, the FDA ordered fenfluramine to be removed from the market altogether. Nearly 5 million Americans had taken fen-phen. But as an obese person, I can totally imagine wanting to do this, ignoring what's been said about it. I get it. We all want to be skinny legends. But not all of us are. At number 8, we have the missing link. Scientists are always trying to find answers from A to Z. What caused this? What came first, the chicken or the egg? God, b***h. Okay. Back in 1999, a fossil was found and smuggled out of China, and it was a big deal because it seemed to be a dinosaur with bird-like plumage. Paleontologists were buzzing because everyone thought this was the link needed to prove birds evolved from dinosaurs. It was displayed at the National Geographic Society, but turns out the whole thing was a hoax, and everyone felt pretty stupid. The fossil ended up being the experiment of a Chinese farmer who had rigged together a meat-eater's tail and bird bits. So I'm guessing he had the last laugh, because the paleontologists were crying. So, RIP. Falling on number 7 slot is the evidence of life. I want more than anything for there to be other life in this universe. I want to believe aliens into existence, and I can't wait for the day they finally confirm it to be real. August 7th, 1996 was apparently that day, and also FYI, that was exactly 1 year before I was born. Coincidence? I think not. August 7th, just a good day overall. Not gonna lie, legends were born. Either way, back in 1996, NASA scientists were investigating a 6.3-ounce rock that had broken off a Mars meteorite and landed in Antarctica back in the 80s. The rock contained chemical compounds that suggested bacteria existed on Mars 3.6 billion years ago. The discovery was so profound that one newspaper even wrote August 7th, 1996 could go down as one of the most important days in human history. Oh, how they were wrong. Within 2 years of the existence of life announcement, traces of those compounds were found in the surrounding Antarctic ice as well. Even other rocks from the moon, where we know life doesn't exist, showed the exact same evidence of life. So by November of 1998, everyone was like, damn it, we screwed up, there's no life on Mars. And it still be like that. Now at number 6 is Pluto. I know it's always gonna be too soon to talk about Pluto being demoted from a planet, but I need to talk about it. It has to see the light. It was discovered as the 9th planet from the sun back in 1930, and since then it has always been one of the planets. Pluto had always been a bit different to the other planets. It was smaller, and as our telescopes got better, we started discovering other objects that were the same size as Pluto, and we were like, did we just jump the gun with this one? And they did. In 2005, a dwarf planet called Eris was discovered, which was 27% bigger than Pluto. So if Pluto was a planet, then Eris had to be one too, making the 9-planet model just wrong. So the term planet had to be defined, and that cut Pluto from the running. But I mean, we will always stan. Viva la Pluto. Always. Now growing up, anytime it was cold outside, my parents would always tell me to put a hat on, since humans lose most of their body heat through their head. Cause scientifically, there's a lack of fat in your head as opposed to everywhere else on your body. Wrong again. You lose just as much heat from any other body part. Your head is usually just the only exposed part of your body, hence it's just colder. There's no science to back it. Your parents are telling you myths. At number 4 is scientific fraud, which is surprisingly more common than you'd think, which is just simply very worrying. Back in 1961, Australian obstetrician William McBride was celebrated worldwide when he alerted the world to the dangers of thalidomide, a sedative prescribed for people with morning sickness or anxiety. Based on anecdotal observations, William hypothesized that the drug caused infants to be born with serious limb deformities, and he actually turned out to be right. Thalidomide was removed from the market, and that was that. But William wasn't satisfied with just those 5 minutes of fame. No, we always need more. 2 decades later, he wrote a report about a morning sickness drug called Devon Dogs that had caused birth defects in rabbits. The drug was quickly taken off the market, seeing as the claim came from a very trusted doctor. However, it turns out he had altered all the data his assistants had carried out. Devon Dogs had 0 negative effects, and he was found guilty of scientific fraud in 1993. William, William, William. Baby, what is you doing? He should have just taken the thalidomide high horse and ran with it. Following at number 3 slot is the epic nuclear winter. Now, during the 80s, when the nuclear arms race was still underway between the US and the Soviet Union, astronomer Carl Sagan co-wrote an article called Nuclear Winter: Global Consequences of Multiple Nuclear Explosions. That article discussed how a nuclear war would send a giant dust cloud into the atmosphere, and that it would cover the world, blocking out sunlight and thrusting us into a winter ice age. An event resulting in conditions that were similar to the ones that made dinosaurs go extinct, so that's no small feat. The article took everyone by surprise and worry, as you can imagine, but skeptics started coming out saying Sagan's model ignored many factors, like how high the dust cloud would have to travel so to not come down as rainfall. By 1990, Sagan admitted his initial temperature calculations were completely wrong, that a nuclear war would decrease the average global temperature by 2.2 degrees Celsius, which I mean is not exactly a nuclear winter, is it, Carl? No, it's not. Nuclear autumn, maybe. Now at number 2 is the asteroid. Back in March of 1998, the front page headlines of the New York Times read as follows. Asteroid is expected to make a pass close to Earth in 2028. This was because the director of the Central Bureau of Astronomical Telegrams, Brian G. Marsden, predicted that on the 26th of October 2028, a mile-wide asteroid would pass Earth. It would travel within 30,000 miles of us, which got everyone worried and thinking about the asteroid that crashed into Earth 65 million years ago and killed all the dinosaurs. Like, what if this one kills all of us this time? That is a possibility. To calculate an asteroid's path, you have to make multiple measurements to most accurately define its trajectory. However, Marsden's were quite off. It's now believed that the asteroid will pass Earth at a safe distance of 600,000 miles, so Marsden can put a sock in it, to be honest. We Gucci. We Gucci. We Gucci. Oh, by the way, in case everyone didn't hear that, we Gucci. Remember when everyone used to come for you for saying what's Gucci? I read every single one of your hate comments. Y'all are monsters. Finally, at number 1 are vaccines. With the late 90s came the emergence of the very popular claim that vaccines cause autism. False before I even get into it. So false, it's actually not even funny. Back in 1995, a group of researchers published a study claiming people that got the MMR vaccine were more likely to develop bowel disease. Based on that study, gastroenterologist Andrew Wakefield started studying the link between the vaccine and autism. 3 years later, Andrew and 12 other authors published a case series in which they claimed they found evidence in 12 cases of the vaccine causing autism. This obviously took the world by storm. There are still so many anti-vaxxers today that I'm like, what are you doing? The 12 years that followed the publication saw no other studies confirming their findings at all. It was also super sus that Andrew never revealed that countless attorneys who were filing lawsuits against vaccine manufacturers were the ones paying him at the time of publication. His research was fatally flawed, and he also falsified the data about the kids' conditions. He claimed 8 out of the 12 kids showed symptoms of autism days after the vaccine was administered, when it was only 2 kids, and those 2 had developmental delays before the vaccine even happened. Andrew, you're full of shit. you're done now. And that is it for today's video, guys. I hope it was informative for you. It was very informative for me. I was like, damn, science, you be wrong sometimes, though. Let me know what you guys thought in the comments below. As always, I'm your host, Ayman Hassan, and I'll catch you in the next one. Bye. Combining phentermine, a stimulant, and fenfluramine, an appetite with
Darren!
Why? It's fine, we start early, so I have time, right? Okay. And fenfluramine. 2 decades later, he wrote a report about a morning sickness drug called Debendox. 2 decades later, he wrote a report about a morning sickness drug called Duh. 2 decades later, he wrote a report about a morning sickness drug called Debendox. 2 decades later, he wrote a report about a morning sickness drug called Debendox. 2 decades later, he wrote a more.